Hello all, I welcome you all to the 15th lecture of this course E614, and today we will talk about the bipolar junction transistor. Basically we will introduce this topic, and in the next video we will dive deep into the currents and charges in the junction and so forth. So first we will just see a bit of historic perspective, and then we will see why we need a bipolar junction transistor. And if time permits, I would really love to show you two articles by the original inventors Bardeen and Brathain, because it's instructive to look at the simplicity of the work that they presented and the clarity of the thought that they had. Okay, so let's start. So basically the first one, the first transistor as such was invented, and the word itself was invented in 1947 by Bardeen and W.H. Brathain. Prior to 1947, semiconductors were there, but then they were used mostly in thermistors, photodiodes, rectifiers and such. So 1947-48 was the first identification of a transistor, which they called as point contact transfer resistor, which is what is called this transistor. And in 1951, Shockley gave the classic PN junction minority carrier injection theory that we saw previously, and this is the starting point, because Shockley greatly simplified the transistor design, and then he came with a particular design that we are very familiar now, right? PNP or NPN for whatever, right? Which is now much easier to fabricate. And then it just blew from this point onwards until now, where we have billions of transistors on a small chip, and we are going even further than that, right? So Shockley's ideal diode equation. So now let us briefly see what's the need for a bipolar junction, or the third contact in a normal PN junction. It all started with this characteristic of a normal PN diode, which has this rectifying behavior. In the forward bias, you have this knee and then a very sharp increase in current, right? But what really interested people is the reverse bias characteristics, which was almost constant current, which is J naught for at least till a large potential bias. And then you have this breakdown, which we discussed previously, right? It is this constant reverse bias current, which was very interesting, because now you have a junction, or you have a device whose current does not depend upon, J does not depend upon, does not depend on the potential V, and hence does not depend upon the load resistor RL. So in the case that we have, let us take a PN junction, right, and then you have it connected to some potential V and RL. So if you bias it in the reverse bias, you have a current I naught, which is independent of the load resistance. And this kind of gives you a feel for what is called as a current source, right? This is your ideal current source. So PN junction at reverse bias is an ideal current source. But then it is not yet a current source, right? Because the current cannot be changed. So how do you change the current? There are two ways to do it. So how to modulate the current So from our previous treatment, we know that the minority or the reverse bias current is basically minority carrier dependent, is Q, let's say Pn naught root dp by tau p, plus the n component. So basically it depends a lot on the minority carrier concentration, which you can actually increase if I take a PN junction, right, and you have a large depletion depending upon the width, depending upon the applied bias, right? And if you shine light through this, right, you have a reverse bias current, this is IV, which will change depending upon the, right, increasing the illumination. Actually, it does not go like that, it goes like this, right? So increasing the illumination increases the minority carrier current, but however you do not have sources of illumination at all possible devices, and hence this is not the most ideal solution to increase the current in this reverse bias. How do you generally increase? The idea that was proposed is you have a reverse bias junction, a P and an N. So basically this is reverse bias, and you have a N to be much larger than P and much less doped, and you attach to this reverse bias junction a small emitter, right, which can actually inject electrons into this P, and which is the equivalent of injecting the minority carriers into P. Right. And if you have this P small enough, there is an idea that you can actually have these electrons now tunnel across this potential barrier or depletion width, as so we call, and then it can reach the collector, so to speak. This is where the terminologies came. So this collector collects the current from the emitted place, from the emitter, right, and then it contributes to what is called as the collector current. We will go into detail as to how these things are actually defined, what are the actual values and stuff, but this is the motivation, right? So you take a reverse bias junction and you add the third junction to actually inject minority carriers into this reverse bias, and you can control the current in the collector depending upon the injection, as well as this third current called the base, which modulates this transfer. Right. So basically, higher this base current, you can see that you will have more recombination in the P, because let us say you are injecting electrons here and you are injecting holes through this particular junction. So you can actually reduce the electron number which crosses this PN junction, causing the collector current. Right. So you can modulate the emitter to collector current characteristics by changing the base current. So this is the general idea. So now there are different ways in which you can bias these two junctions, and it gives you this different operating conditions. First one is called as a normal or active, when you have both this, you call this the emitter and you call this the collector, right? If both emitter base junction and collector base junction, sorry, if the emitter base junction is forward and the collector base junction is the reverse, this is the way in which this device was actually idealized, was formulated, right? So this is the normal operation or active operation, where emitter base is forward biased and base collector is reverse biased. You have a second mode of operation which is called as a saturation, when you have the emitter base to be in forward bias and your base collector to also be in forward bias. The third one, obvious one, is the cutoff condition, where both of them are reverse bias. So basically there are no current injection anywhere. So typically the current dies off in this entire junction. So basically you have your emitter base in the reverse bias and your base collector again in reverse. And the fourth one is say fourth possibility in this two junction, basically you have just two alternatives and then you keep switching between forward and reverse, right? The fourth one being the inverse, where you have the emitter base to be reverse biased and base collector to be forward biased. So, we will go into detail as to into the detailed operation, the charges, the depletion with the currents in these junctions. But these are just the broad ways in which this triple or this bijunction device can actually work. Right? But before we go into those details, I would like to spend a few minutes on the original article, because it is just insanely simple and elegant, and it's actually instructive to just see them, right? So these are the two articles. The first one being the transistor being the semiconductor triode, right? And you can see the look, you can see, so this was done in 1948 by Bardeen and Bretain. So just take a look when you have the time, download this paper and read it, right? And you can see the simplicity of this particular design. The actual design in which they fabricated it, I'm sure many people would have seen this in pictures. So they took a block of germanium and then they placed on top of this a plastic separator of sorts, and on this side they put one metallic contact, on this side they put another metallic contact, right? This germanium was a n-type germanium, right? And you put a metal on top. You can see that at that time, they thought that you should have a p-type region here. Sorry. So you should form two p-type regions here, leaving behind a small n-type region, giving you the p and p that we recently we just now discussed, right? So why did they think you will have two p-type regions here? You can see that this junction, so this is a metal semiconductor junction. We have another metal semiconductor junction. We have not yet discussed a metal semiconductor junction, but you can typically see that if you put a metal and a semiconductor together, you will form some kind of a depletion width, right? So you have a depletion width here, you have a second depletion width here, but they think that the depletion width is p-type. Why? It comes from, again, their understanding, right? So they explain that beautifully here. So you have a metal with a Fermi level here, right? And what happens at the interface, the metal will share electrons. So you have a n-type semiconductor, which has a much higher Fermi level. So let us draw this, this structure for once, so that we understand what happens at this metal semiconductor interface. And then we can understand why you will form a p-type at the interface, right? So I have a metal with a filled band below, and I have a semiconductor which is n-type. So they have taken germanium, it does not matter which semiconductor you take, and you germanium has a Fermi level higher than the metal, right? So basically it has its Fermi level here. This is metallic work function, but when you join together, both of them should match at equilibrium, right? The Fermi levels should be in sync. So what happens? Electrons in the conduction band of germanium will fall down, right? So you will form a depletion width, and this guy should bend up, right? We understand this. As this guy goes up, typically it means that your Fermi level is now much farther from the conduction band edge. So basically you lose the electrons in this region, right? So the final band structure will look like this. Your metal, Fermi level continuing, this will be the band structure of silicon, the germanium. So this is what you call as a Schottky barrier. We will go into details of this metal semiconductor junction later on, but it is just to show that it is definitely n-type here because the Fermi level is much closer to the conduction band, right? And in this region, very close to the interface with the metal, so this is a metal. In this region where the you can see that the Fermi level gets pretty close to the valence band, so they said the depletion width is more p than n, right? Because your Fermi level is now much closer to the valence band than the conduction band, hence giving you a feel that you have a p-type very close to the interface and thereby forming a very simple p-n-p junction. So I just want you to read these two papers and then look at the elegance at which they have explained this this formation of p-n-p. But currently the way you actually make a BJT is much more complicated than what is shown here, right? So we will take a minute to actually understand how a current BJT is made so that you appreciate the way in which it was originally thought of and then originally fabricated, and now how do they actually make it. So how do currently how do we make a BJT? The BJT fabrication process starts with taking a big let's take a simple p-type silicon, okay? Take a p-type silicon. They put a strong N++ diffusion. We saw previously how to make diffusions, right? So you either drive it through or you put a metal and then do drive in, or you do ion implantation. So these are the methods we saw last time. So that's how you can do this. But then you have to mask it. So what they do is they put a silicon dioxide mask and then drive in, let us say, arsenic or phosphorus or something of that sort of type 5 valence to make donors. And then you put this large donor implantation, right? And once you do this donor implantation, so what they do is they cover some region with another silicon dioxide. Remember, all these things are not, we just draw it much easily, but they cannot do this local area deposition. What they do is they do a complete silicon dioxide deposition and then etch out regions in other places to give you actually this part of silicon dioxide, right? And then on top of this, they deposit a region of n-type silicon. They grow it epitaxially. This is another process called chemical vapor deposition process. They can grow a doped semiconductor directly, right? So this is a way to do this. Once they do this, you can deposit on, they will deposit on top of this a layer of polysilicon, right? Something of this sort. Again, by CVD, you have what is called a polysilicon. A polycrystalline silicon means that it is not crystalline everywhere. It has a lot of defects, lot of small grains. But this guy is a single crystal, and here you have a polycrystalline silicon. Again, very heavily doped, but then now it is doped with boron. Now what they do is they heat it to very high temperatures. This boron will diffuse inside. It will not diffuse into silicon because silicon is a boron stopper. So this guy will diffuse inside. You will get a region like this. It is typically spherical, right? So basically the diffusion is spherically symmetric. So you will get a very strong P+ region here, right? So once this is done, now they put another, they'll do another process and then put up another, let's say, a semiconducting, another polysilicon layer, right? And they form, sorry, so after this, what they do is they drive in boron through this region, and then they form a p-type diffusion, a mild p-type diffusion. This is n-type, which is was below, right? You can deposit a mild p-type diffusion into this, so giving you a p-type layer here, right? Further, they will once again deposit a small n-type region. So this is an n-type polysilicon, right? And now what happens is you have it will they will let you diffuse to finally give an n-type region. So we just discussed this particular fabrication process. This is called as a self-aligned BJT fabrication process, which involves some 20-30 fabrication steps, because each of these regions where we show that you have a localized deposition or a small region of polysilicon cannot be done in this fashion. It has to be done on the wafer scale, and then you have to do a lithography process, you have to do an etch process to actually do this. But all these things are done to just realize this PNP with the reasonable contacts, while Berdin and Bretain just realized this with very simple plastic stands suspended by a spring and metallic contacts on the top. Of course, you can see the difficulty, right? So this cannot be batch fabricated. You cannot have millions of such devices. So the idea of doing something like this came from Shockley, who actually gave this PNP in a planar fashion. And that's where it's from there that it got developed to do this kind of to come down to this kind of architecture. Right. So with this sort of brief introduction into a BJT, we will meet in the next lecture to do a little bit more detailed analysis of the charges and the currents in BJT. However, maybe one last thing that I will tell. So I'm sure many people have already seen. So you have these three junctions, which is an emitter, a base, collector. Right. There are different ways to connect this. If the base is grounded, you draw this particular structure like this, right? If this is emitter, this is collector, and this is base, and you typically draw arrows to show the direction of current, right? If it is an NPN transistor, you have electrons being injected from here to here, right? So the electrons are actually going down like this. So the actual current goes in this fashion, right? So you draw the current direction by this arrow. And if you ground the base, you call it as a common base NPN transistor. However, if you have a P-type or if you have a PNP BJT, again base, you have a PNP region. So you are again base, emitter, base, and collector, right? Now the current is in opposite direction, right? Because you emit holes from here, so your current follows the direction of holes, right? So you have something like this. If this is grounded, you have a common base structure. If your emitter is grounded, you have a common emitter structure. And quite trivially, if the collector is grounded, you have a common collector structure, right? So these are the most common representations, most common architectures. But let us now discuss in the next time we meet about the band structure and the currents in this junction. Thank you.